It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is an urgent question. And I call Sue Webber.
Thank you very much. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the statement that NHS Lothian services are under extreme pressure and that patients should not attend the emergency department unless it is life-threatening.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
He's online today.
Question. Our health and care system is under extreme pressure due to the pandemic, and NHS Lothian, like of course all health boards, is experiencing significant pressure, including workforce challenges, the high level of delayed discharge, which is inevitably affecting waiting times in the A&E. We recognise that some people aren't getting the service of care they, or indeed we would expect, and I apologise to anyone, of course, that has suffered as a result of that. It's our ambition to ensure that more patients receive person-centred care in the right place, in the right time, and in a way that helps staff deliver high-quality care in treatment. That's why we invested £23 million this year to support the development of the redesign of urgent care. I recently also announced a £300 million package of winter measures that includes a focus on bolstering the caring workforce by increasing the numbers and providing them with additional support. Along with my senior officials, I've met with the executive team at NHS Lothian this morning, and we've agreed a set of immediate actions that will support improvements and minimise delays for patients.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The figures released yesterday confirmed that we have the worst A&E waiting times on record. And since the Cabinet Secretary's NHS recovery plan was published in August, more than 55,000 people have waited over 4 hours to be seen in A&E, and over 11,000 of those people have been from NHS Lothian. After the advice from NHS Lothian last night, there has rightly been a lot of concern from people about having to self-diagnose whether something is life-threatening or not. Some injuries are not life-threatening, but are serious. A broken ankle may not kill. A stroke left untreated can have life-changing consequences. Does the Cabinet Secretary now accept that the Government's recovery plan was not sufficient? And does he endorse this advice from NHS Lothian? And if so, how can people access treatment that they need?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Sue Webber for what is an important question? I think all health boards, all clinicians would say that if you think your condition, of course, is critical or life-threatening, do not hesitate for a second. Call 999 or get yourself to your A&E department. But of course, if you do not think it's critical or life-threatening, then there are other alternative pathways, such as calling NHS 24, for example. But of course, people should err on the side of caution if they feel their injury, condition, or that of a family member or friend is critical or indeed life-threatening. But it is important people listen to the advice of clinicians, of the health board, because I think all of us would accept, all of us would understand that those that are working in our hospitals and right across our NHS only want the best for the people that they treat. But this is a time of extreme pressure. And what I would say to Sue Webber is this government will continue to invest. Of course, we are facing the most significantly challenging winter the NHS has ever suffered. And this is going to be, of course, of cold comfort to people who are waiting in A&E departments. Our performance is not where I'd want it to be, but it is, of course, or it is the case that our A&E departments are the best performing in the entire UK. And the reason I mention that, of course, is because just to highlight that these are common challenges that are being faced right across the UK. So we'll continue to invest in my £300 million winter package that I announced. I know health boards are working around the clock, try to maximise capacity by safely discharging those who are clinically safe to discharge back into community settings.
Sue Webber.
Thank you. This morning, a constituent of mine got in touch with me by text. She was too scared and upset to go into work at the Royal Infirmary because she knew that people had been waiting for over 30 hours in A&E due to the lack of beds. And in the announcement, NHS Lothian Chief Executive Callum Campbell admitted that NHS Lothian hospitals are close to capacity and the hospital system is under extreme duress. NHS Lothian has asked for mutual aid to help ease the sustained pressures on their teams and their patients. Will the government provide this aid? And what message does the Cabinet Secretary have for hard-working NHS frontline staff who are having similar fears as that of my constituent?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first and foremost, can I thank Sue Webber's constituent for all that they have done during the pandemic, but particularly at the moment during this very significant period of challenge. I also spoke to a clinician this morning who works in one of the Edinburgh hospital sites, and again, they reiterated how challenging and pressured the system is. I spoke to Callum Campbell, as well as the NHS chair of NHS Lothian chair, John Conaghan, this morning. They have had really urgent and rapid discussions with the local authority partners, with the HSCPs in the region, and they are making exceptionally good progress. They feel they can make exceptionally good progress in order to safely discharge those people who are clinically safe to discharge from hospitals into community. And of course, the effect that will have is freeing up capacity, which will also help with flow within the hospital. And that is what the winter announcement package was there to help. And look, I won't pretend otherwise. Even with that increased investment, this will still be a very, very challenging winter ahead. Performance will continue to be difficult, but certainly, of course, where boards ask for aid, and that aid can be provided, of course, we will leave no stone unturned in helping our health boards at this difficult time.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary asked people to think twice before calling an ambulance. Now patients are being told in Lothian to hold off completely unless it's life-threatening. This winter, the NHS is reaching the crux of years of under-resourcing and mismanagement. It is in genuine jeopardy. Now, I personally don't have a medical degree, so I'd be grateful for some advice from the Cabinet Secretary. What exactly does life-threatening mean? And then will the Health Secretary accept that asking people to judge for themselves whether or not their condition is life-threatening will possibly prove deadly?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've already said to Sue Webber, if people feel that their condition is critical or life-threatening, of course, they should pick up the phone, call 999, get an ambulance, or indeed, if they're able to get someone to transport them to an A&E department, then get themselves to an A&E department. Of course, there are other pathways available if you are not critical or life-threatening, and that would be, for example, to call NHS 24, which is a 24/7 helpline, of course, to be able to get that assistance. But every health board in the country certainly is under pressure. We know that, and therefore, if we are able to assist by using alternative pathways, if your condition is not critical or life-threatening, then of course that is the advice that is being given right across the board.
Fiona Hislop.
NHS Lothian made absolutely clear in the most recent briefings to MSPs and the Lothians that one of the major pressures their hard-working staff are facing in the enduring pandemic, alongside high levels of staff illness and self-isolation, is the acute staff shortages in social care, which is impacting on the whole health and care system, vacancies elsewhere, and shortage of EU workers. Can the Minister state what the very recently produced adult social care winter plan can do to help these pressures?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Fiona Hislop for, again, what is an incredibly important question. Again, the Adult Social Care Winter Plan, plus the winter plan that was produced in relation to the £300 million winter package, it really does focus on social care, because we know if we can bolster the social care workforce, then we can help at both the front door and the back door of our acute services. We can prevent people from going to hospital, hopefully, if they have the care at home and care home packages that they need, but also, of course, we can help at the delayed discharge end by safely discharging people to community settings, again, where that is clinically safe to do so. So the £300 million I announced, £48 million of that is being made available to increase the hourly rate of social care staff. That will match NHS Band 2 staff. It will also help to recruit 1,000 additional NHS staff to support MDTs, multidisciplinary teams. And over £60 million of that investment was to maximise capacity at care home and care, of care at home services. So there is a significant amount of investment going into this. Of course, it will take some time to recruit the workforce that I have mentioned, but I know every single health board is looking to do that as a matter of urgency and pace.
Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, people urgently need frontline health support, and many are going to A&E because they or their family members are having a health crisis and they can't get the support locally. I've been inundated with patients in the Riverside Surgery area, Musselburgh, for example, who have got heartbreaking stories about not being able to access GP services predating the pandemic, but the issue has been raised by other constituents across the region. So can the Cabinet Secretary say what he is doing now to ensure patients have the local medical services they need as well as the support they need when they attempt to access accident emergency services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Sarah Boyack for her question? I met recently with Colin Beattie, MSP, who raised this issue with me around Riverside Medical Practice, and again have offered to continue the dialogue with him. And of course, I would extend that offer to Sarah Boyack also to see how we can assist in that. Of course, it is for the local health board to take forward those issues. But in terms of local services, I wrote jointly with the BMA recently that every single GP practice in the country, including those, of course, in the Lothian Health Board region, where I laid out quite explicitly my expectation that given the changes in guidance, there would be an increase in face-to-face GP appointments, which we know may well help in this regard. And can I thank GPs for the incredible hard work that they are doing at this time. And of course, when it comes to other local services, again, the investments that I've already mentioned will help to bolster some of those local services and hopefully take that pressure off acute settings.
Julian Mackay. Ms. Mackay?
The executive has said that the board has...
Sorry, do continue, Ms. Mackay. We can hear you now. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. NHS Lothian's chief executive has said that the board has requested mutual aid, but I'm concerned about other health boards' capacity to fulfil this request. As we know, the issues facing NHS Lothian are impacting health boards across the country. And just a few days ago, NHS Lanarkshire moved to its highest risk level. What assurance can the Cabinet Secretary provide that requests for mutual aid can be met and that health boards that are struggling will be provided with the assistance they need?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Gillian Mackay is, of course, absolutely correct. Every single health board area is under pressure and under strain. Where they can request, where they can get potentially mutual aid is, for example, reaching out to the Golden Jubilee, and they can help, for example, with planned care. And we know how important, of course, it is to try to address issues with planned care, particularly where there's been a postponement of P2, P3, P4, groups of surgery, because we know if those backlogs continue to increase, then of course we're just storing up problems for the future. So it is for each health board to discuss with other health boards what mutual aid may well be available. Of course, where a request comes in for other support, such as military support, then we of course will also give that serious consideration and pass that on to the military and the armed forces where appropriate and necessary.
Thank you. That concludes the urgent question. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 1797 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak on the motion. The question is that motion 1797 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of four Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 1798 on Code of Conduct for Councillors, 1799 on Model Code of Conduct for Members of Devolved Public Bodies, 1800 on approval of an SSI, and 1801 on designation of a lead committee.
And happy to move all of them. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The questions on these motions will be put at decision time, and there are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 1769.4 in the name of Liam Kerr, which seeks to amend motion 1769 in the name of Michael Matheson on global ambitions for COP26 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.